Alright, so this video is about the arterial blood supply of the upper limb, all the way from the axillary artery until the tip of your fingers. So, as you know, the aorta leaves the heart, giving off the left common carotid artery, the left subclavian, and the brachiocephalic trunk, which divides into the right common carotid artery and the right subclavian. Now from here, we're going to have to follow the subclavian artery, as the major blood supply to the upper extremities comes from the subclavian artery. Now, as soon as the subclavian artery passes the first rib, it's going to become the axillary artery. And this is really where we're going to start. The axillary artery is going to pass through the axilla, and then when it reaches the lower border of the teres major, it will continue as the brachial artery. Now, this landmark really depends from textbook to textbook. In some places, you could see it written as the free margin of the pectoralis major determines the border between the axillary and the brachial artery. And both are essentially correct, as you see here. It really depends on which source you're studying from. So, the brachial artery will continue to the forearm, and then it will split into two terminal branches, the radial artery, laterally, and the ulnar artery, medially. So, as these two descend along the forearm and reach the hand, the radial artery in the lateral side is going to enter the dorsum of the hand, and then it will re-enter the palm of the hand between the two heads of the dorsal interosseous muscles as the deep palmar arch. So this is the palm of the hand, keep that in mind. The ulnar artery is going to enter the hand as the superficial palmar arch. So now that we've made our base, let's fill this up with the side branches. So let's get back to the armpit and do the axillary artery. The axillary artery can be divided into three parts, using the pectoralis minor as a landmark, because the first part is the part of the artery that is medial to pectoralis minor. The second part lies behind pec minor, and the third part lies laterally to pec minor. The first part has one artery, called the superior thoracic artery, supplying the deep muscles of the first and the second intercostal spaces. The second part, however, has two side branches. It has an artery that splits into four, called the thoracoacromial artery. For these, just remember A, P, C, D, switching the letter B with a P. A for acromial, P for pectoral artery, supplying the pectoralis muscle and the mammary gland in females. C for clavicular, supplying the subclavius muscle. And D for deltoid, supplying the deltoid muscle and the pectoralis major muscle. So that's this one. The second side branch of the axillary artery behind the pectoralis minor is the lateral thoracic artery, supplying the anterior serratus muscles on the side. And as it makes its way to the anterior serratus, it gives off the lateral mammary arteries in females for the mammary glands. So that's the two branches behind the pec minor. For the last part of the axillary artery, we need to add the scapula, because it gives off the subscapular artery, supplying the subscapular muscle. And then as the subscapular artery continues, it divides into two terminal branches, and those are the thoracodorsal, which goes down along the lateral margin of the scapula, supplying the anterior serratus muscle, just like the lateral thoracic artery, and it also supplies the lats, the latissimus muscles, hence the name thoracodorsal. Both muscles are located on the posterior side. The other one is the scapular circumflex artery, which curves back to the infraspinous fossa, forming a loop, and then it will eventually meet up with the suprascapular artery. Remember this one, coming from the thyrocervical trunk of the subclavian artery. The other two arteries are associated with the humerus, and they are the anterior and the posterior humeral circumflex arteries, going around the cervical neck of the humerus, supplying the structures there, like the shoulder joint and the deltoid muscles. So that's the axillary artery. Now moving over to the brachial artery under the teres major, or the free margin of the pectoralis major. The brachial artery lies on the medial bicipital groove between the biceps and the triceps on the medial side. The cool thing with this artery is that this is the artery you usually want to auscultate when you want to measure the blood pressure on someone's arm. The other cool thing with this artery is that As it descends along the arm, it basically sends out many side branches supplying the muscles of the anterior compartment of the arm. And those are the coracobrachialis, the biceps, and the brachialis muscle. But it do have side branches, and I want to use this humerus over here to visualize them. It has a deep brachial, or the profunda brachii, which goes behind the humerus in a groove called sulcus nervi radialis. It will supply the whole posterior compartment of the arm with blood, so the triceps, as well as supplying the bone itself. The rest of the arteries will work together to form a vascular network in the region of the elbow. Our first artery is the inferior ulnar collateral. It arises above the medial epicondyle of the humerus, and then it will pass in front of it. The superior ulnar collateral lies in the groove of the ulnar nerve, which, remember, lies behind the epicondyle. And a way to remember that is that that's the nerve that hurts so much when you hit your lower medial part of the elbow on something. That's because the nerve is located on the lower medial part of the epicondyle. So that's the superior ulnar collateral. Then posteriorly, there's the radial collateral and the medial collateral from the deep brachial artery going down towards the elbow. Now on the opposite side, there's the recurrent radial that starts from the radial artery communicating with the radial collateral, as you see here. And on the ulnar side, there's the recurrent ulnar, which divides into the anterior and the posterior branch. The anterior goes with the inferior ulnar, and the posterior goes with the superior ulnar collateral. The medial collateral artery that's left alone is a little special one, and it has its own special partner. Remember the membrane that's between the radius and ulna? What was the name of that membrane? It's the interoceous membrane. The ulnar artery sends out an artery called the common interoceous artery, which basically divides into two arteries, one going behind the interoceous membrane and one in front, and they're called the anterior and the posterior interoceous branches. Thank God this doesn't have any special name. Now, since the medial collateral artery is located behind the elbow, then its body comes from the posterior interoceous artery, called the recurrent interoceous artery. All of this is called rete cubiti, and that is the vascular network in the region of the elbow. Now, let's continue and look at the radial artery. The radial artery will continue down between the brachioradial and the flexor carpi radialis muscle, and then once it reaches the lower part of the arm above the stirrate process of the radius, you can actually feel the pulse of this artery. Try that now. Put the tip of the index finger and the middle finger on top of the stirrate process of the radius on the inside of the wrist. You should be able to feel the radial artery pulsating. So now let's continue with this artery. After it passes the stirrate process, it winds backwards behind the muscles of the thumb, the thernal muscles they're called, as you see here. The artery is going to go back and then underneath the tendons of these two muscles highlighted here in red, the extensor pollicis longus and the abductor pollicis longus. It passes the anatomical snuffbox and then it pierces the muscles of the first intercostal space. And then it will end up on the palmar side again, to meet up with the deep palmar artery of the ulnar artery, making the deep palmar arch. So the radial artery supplies the whole anterior compartment of the forearm plus the radial side of the posterior compartment. The radial artery gives off the superficial palmar branch, which meets up with the ulnar artery, making up the superficial palmar arch. So these two arches are really important blood source for the muscles of the hands. So the wrist also needs some blood, and it gets that by the dorsal and the palmar carpal network. The palmar carpal network is formed by the palmar carpal arteries, one coming from the radial artery and one from the ulnar artery. The posterior carpal network is formed by four arteries. Two dorsal carpal arteries, one from the ulnar and one from the radial, the posterior interoceous artery, and also the anterior interoceous artery will pierce the membrane and also contribute to the dorsal carpal network. And that is the rete palmaris. Now, lastly, let's do the blood supply of the hands. I know you're tired, and this is probably a lot to take in through one short video, but we're soon done here. So, I already mentioned that the palm is supplied by the superficial and the deep palmar arch. The superficial palmar arch will give off three common palmar digital arteries, and each of them will divide into two arteries called the proper palmar digital. And then they will supply the radial side of the little finger, the ring finger, the middle finger, and the ulnar side of the index finger. The thumb and the ulnar side of the index finger are supplied by the palmar digital arteries, coming from the princeps pollicis artery, or the principal artery of the thumb, as you see here, coming from the radial artery, just as it enters the palm. And as it forms a deep palmar arch, it gives off the palmar metacarpal arteries, which help with the communication between the deep and the superficial palmar arches, helping with the blood supply to the fingers through the common palmar digital artery. So now you're probably wondering, what about the posterior part of the hand? The whole dorsal part of the hand is supplied by the dorsal carpal network, or the arch. You can also call it the dorsal carpal arch, which give off the dorsal metacarpal arteries dividing into the dorsal digital arteries. So that's all I had for the blood supply of the upper extremities. I know it's a lot to take in straight away, but the more you study it, the easier it becomes. I really hope this video helped you understand this topic. Until next time.